Heavenly Father, we come to you today with so many worries, concerns, and we are forgetting sometimes to see the joys. And sometimes those joys are going to come in small little pieces, and we have to take them when we can get them. The world is so full of uncertainty right now, with fires and hurricanes and you name it, Lord, and it's out there. But we know that we have you. And so we need to put our trust and our faith and our cares and our worries and everything that we know that we can't handle on our own, Lord, we know that we need to give to you. So, Lord, we just ask you today to come and during this time of worship and the message, just rest our souls and let us know that you're in charge. We have no control. We are just so thankful for those little bits and pieces of things that you give to us every single day that we can smile or laugh about in the midst of all the rest of the chaos. Father, we thank you, we praise you, in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
This time our children's church can be who's leading children's church this morning? Oh, right here. All right, awesome. Harley, Indiana. So we have children's church this morning, so feel welcome to be a part of that. So the video that we just saw here, you know, when we were singing the song A Glorious Day, I love that song. Just a reminder that every day that God gives us something new, that God has something new for us to experience. And in that song, you hear the words, who can carry that kind of weight? And Jesus carries all the weight. He wants to be a part of our lives in such a way that we can live in the abundance that he has for us. So this video that we saw, it's a visual reminder of what Jesus did on the cross to make all things new. It's a reminder of what he suffered on the cross and what he sacrificed and that he paid the price to provide everything that we need. Everything that we need to live in peace and with God and live with peace with others. So Jesus came to make all things new. Amen? And we like new, don't we? We like new homes. We like new cars. We like new cell phones. I always love getting my new upgrade every 2 or 3 years. Now, it's never really much different than the phone I had before, but either way, it's still exciting. I mean, every day we see a new invention, we see a new product, and here, for example, here a couple weeks ago, me and Noelle went to our favorite ice cream place, and we saw something new. We saw Red Bull slushies. Anybody ever saw those before? Now, don't worry, because I didn't have one before the service this morning, otherwise I'd go for about 2 or 3 hours, but our society is always creating something new. Something new to sell us, something to attract us, something to excite us. However, I think most of us here, many of us here have probably learned that over the years, the things of this world are very temporary. I can remember moving into my first home that I bought many years ago, and I moved in the fall, and winter was just around the corner. And I can remember it got cold outside, so I went to turn the furnace on, and I didn't hear that click. So I'm like, oh, man. So it's like maybe it's the thermostat or something like that. So I called in the repairman, and he came in and said, you're going to have to replace everything. You know? So my first couple months, I had to get a new furnace, and then I realized how much cold air was coming in my windows. So I had to have all my windows replaced, and then came the mortgage payment, and then came the land taxes came due, and my new home just didn't seem so new anymore. I wasn't quite as excited about it as I was before. And maybe get a new car, right? You know, whether new car or even used car, you have that fresh new car smell, right? And then later on down the road, you talk to a buddy or you have a friend and they got a car that you wish you would have got instead, right? And he's like, why did I get this car? I wanted that car. Or maybe if you go get that one of those Red Bull slushies, maybe you drink it so fast that you get a brain freeze and you wish you never would have drank it in the first place, right? So you see, the things of this world, we cannot depend on them. The things of this world will eventually wear out. I want to share with us in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 31, it reminds us that those who use the things of this world should not become attached to them. For the world as we know it will soon pass away. And it goes on, we see here in 1 Timothy 6, 17, a very familiar passage. Teach those who are rich in this world not to be proud and not to trust in their money because it's so unreliable. Their trust should be in God who richly gives us all we need for our enjoyment. So God richly wants to give to us everything that we need. So a question that we have to wrestle with each day, I think, is, are you attached to God or are you attached to the things of this world? In other words, do you trust God to give you new things that will never wear out, things that cannot be replaced, things that will renew you each day and will truly bring you the joy and the peace that God calls us to have? 2 Corinthians 4, verses 16 through 17 tell us this. So no wonder we don't give up. For even though our outer person gradually wears out, can anybody testify to that? Amen. Our inner being is being renewed every single day. We view our slight, short-lived troubles in the light of eternity. We see our difficulties as the substance that produces an eternal, weighty glory far beyond comparison. I love those words, so no wonder we do not give up. I mean, some of us, especially these last 6 months, I mean, we've been going through some troubled times, right? All of us have. And some of you are going through some personal struggles and challenges. And many times you just feel like giving up. And we know people, whether in our family or people around us, who have given up. But as children of God, the words, I can't, should never be in our vocabulary. The words, you know, things will never change, and that group of people will never change, or things will never change here, or, you know, or that's impossible. Because God is always doing a new thing. Every single day in our lives, in this great relationship, and the God who richly gives to us, each day should be a beginning of a new faith. It should be a beginning of God working in our lives each day, and it should be a time where we are embracing relationships and sharing the gospel with others. A couple of weeks ago, me and Noel, we went and watched, we didn't go and watch, we've watched a lot of movies at home, especially these last 6 months. And we saw the movie Indiana Jones. Now, it was the last movie, so Henry Ford was just a little bit older. Any other Indiana Jones fans out there? Yeah. I mean, who doesn't like Indiana Jones? And I love watching these movies. Yeah, the whip and everything, right? I love watching these movies, all of them, you know, the whole series of them, because there's always one adventure after another. I mean, 1 minute they're here, and then you see on the map, you know, and the next minute they're over here. And they're experiencing new challenges in their life. They're exploring, you know, they're having an adventure and they're learning new things. And that's exactly what the Christian life should be like. The Christian life should be an adventure. It should be something exciting, something that we wake up and say, I cannot wait for God to do something new. My mentor, Pastor Ben Davis, would always tell me that the Christian life should be an adventure, waking up every morning, looking forward to God doing something new in your life. And in Isaiah 43:19, it kind of echoes what my mentor would share with me. It says, see, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. Now listen, we have a choice each day to make, don't we? I mean, we can wake up in the morning, we can trust God, and we can look for something new that God wants to do in our lives, or we can wander around the wilderness every single day, and we can gripe, and we can complain. We can ponder about, you know, the should-haves and the would-haves and the could-haves. We can spend all our time in the wasteland arguing with one another and bickering about this issue or that issue. Or we can wake up, we can put on the armor of God that we talked about these past a couple of weeks here in our last series. We can pull up our big boy pants, and we can pull up our big girl pants, and we can wake up and say, hey, God, I'm looking forward to you doing something great today in my life. I'm looking forward to this adventure that you have for me. But the question that we have to ask ourselves is what it says here in the passage. Do we perceive it? Do we recognize it? Are we looking forward, or are we always looking backwards? Are we expecting God to move in your life? And do you believe that God is making a way? Is God making a way through the wilderness and the wasteland, especially this past year? I mean, this past year has been pretty tough, amen? I mean, we've had COVID hit us out of the blue. We've had people who have gotten sick. We've had people who have died from this virus. And not only in this country, but around the world. I mean, a pandemic. I mean, who saw that coming? I mean, the worst one at this level since 1918. However, I just want to remind you that this morning that Jesus has come to make all things new. And take away the medical concerns of the virus that we've been experiencing. There's the mental, the emotional, the relational, the financial effects from this pandemic in many ways are just as devastating as the virus itself. Depression and suicide in our country has increased in young adults by 25% during this short period of time. We also see, working in the recovery field for many years, I still have connections with counselors and substance abuse counselors, and they're telling me that they haven't seen so much relapse in their life before, that they have people who they've worked with who've been clean for 4, 5, 6, 7+ years, and they're relapsing because of the isolation, and they're just not able to work their program the normal way that they would work their program. So there's many people out there suffering, and more people getting addicted to substances like alcohol, drugs. And we also see our churches and our businesses just struggling to remain viable, just struggling to remain open. And on a family level, too, a lot of families have lost income and employment, and they're trying to pay their bills, right? And we have others, though, who are working more than they ever have before fighting this virus, and they're tired and they're burned out. But I want to remind you that Jesus came to make all things new. And on top of all this, we have a divided country, right? I mean, let me ask you a question. I mean, have we forgotten the second greatest command, to love your neighbor as yourself? Because I don't know about you, but I'm not seeing a whole lot of that happening in our country right now. And quite honestly, I fear that the universal church has forgotten as well. Whether politically or whether in our church or whatever it may be, this country, we see this group against that group. We have people picking sides and throwing insults and accusations and hatred and in some cases violence. We're going to talk more about this in our last topic of this series. We're going to talk about how God wants to reconcile us. But I just want to make this point this morning that we should have convictions and we should stand on those convictions. And as God leads us, we should act on those convictions as well. But just as important, we should have children of God, just like God loved us no matter what. We should have the capacity to love and to respect those that we disagree with. Because we can disagree. That's okay. But it's not okay to tear each other down at the same time. Because I truly believe that the only answer to all the problems and division that we have in this country is going to happen through God's church. Because we can't count on our elected officials. And again, I don't care which side or what spectrum you're from. They just put their finger in the air and they follow the wind and maybe they get something done after election time, but usually nothing happens. And there's different groups out there, partisan groups, organizations, again, on both sides that have no acceptance for anyone who disagrees with them. But as children of God, we should have a unified spirit because only Jesus Christ and his church is the one who can heal our country from the hatred and from discrimination and racism and all that other kind of stuff, because Jesus always begins with love. He always begins with love. And so should his people. I want to give you a reminder. We typically use this passage when marriage relationships, but it's a universal passage, and it reminds us of what the kind of love that God has for us is the same type of love that we should have for others. Because I don't know about you, but before I knew Jesus, I was against him. I disagreed with him. I lived against him. But you know what? He still loved me. Let's read this. Let me read this to you. A love is what? It's patient and it's kind. Love does not envy or boast, and it's not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. You see, love is the only thing that can drive out the jealousy and the fear and the hatred and the pride in our society today. And it brings hope, and it brings change. It brings solutions to the many problems that we have. It creates a bridge to where we can actually dialogue instead of tearing one another apart. So over these next several weeks, we're going to be reminded of four things that Jesus wants to do in our lives to make us new, to make us a people, to do new things and to change lives and to follow him the way he would call us. The first one we're going to talk about, we're going to touch a little bit on this morning, is that Jesus wants to redeem us. He wants to deliver us. The second thing is that Jesus wants to restore us. I mean, a lot of us have lost a lot these past months, amen? And Jesus wants to restore and give us back what's been taken and give us back even more. He also wants to revive us. He wants to help us to live passionately with him again, whether it's a personal revival and a revival of the church. And Jesus wants to reconcile us, to change hatred into friendship. Yeah, and even with those that we disagree with. So before I close this morning, let me just talk a little bit about redemption. I want to talk about what that means, because redemption is where we start, right? I mean, we can't be a people of healing. We can't be a people that brings change into a hurting world and newness and freshness until we've been changed first. So this passage here, it's a reminder of who you are as a child of God. 2 Corinthians 5:17, and it says this: therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here, right now. You see, God doesn't just come into our life to improve us. And he doesn't just come into our life to make us better. And he doesn't come in and build an addition and say, here's your Christian room, and here's your selfish room, and here's the room with all your stuff, and here's your work room. No, God comes in, and he tears everything down in our old life, and he creates within us a brand new life. Because where's the passage say here? It says, where's the old? Where's the old? It's gone, right? It no longer exists. Now, you can choose to live there. But it no longer exists. You're going to be wandering in the wilderness. Because God said, I got rid of that in your life. And where's the new? The new is, yes, the here and the now. Even during a pandemic, yes. Even when everything in my life seems to be falling apart, yes. God is still doing new things. God is still providing new mercies and forgiveness every day. And God is doing new miracles in the lives of his people every day. Now, the word redemption, it means to be delivered. So delivered from what? Well, delivered, what this passage talks about, from our old self. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22 through 24 says this: you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by deceitful desires, and to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. What we see in this passage is that our old self is selfish. It's self-centered. It's corrupted, and there's deceit, and that God came to deliver us from that old way of life so that he could fill us with his righteousness and his holiness, which is our new life, to make us right with him and to set us apart as his children, to help us to become more like Jesus and to make us new. This morning, I just want to take a moment whether you're online, you're listening today, or whether you're here on location, I just want us to just stop for a moment and really think about what this means to have a relationship with Jesus. Because many of you may be out there, maybe you're at home, maybe in your living room, right here, and you're just really struggling with what it really means to know Jesus. Yeah, you really don't understand this new life that God has for us. Because I can tell you this, it's the most important decision that you'll ever make in your life. Maybe these past several months, you've just become overwhelmed. Maybe you've known Jesus for many years, and you just feel like you've fallen back, and you've strayed away, and you feel lost, and you feel held captive. Maybe by an addiction that you fell back into, or maybe you're just struggling to find peace in your lives. Well, Jesus came to set us free and to deliver us from death into life. In John 10:10, it says this, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy, and I have come that you may have life and have it to the full. So how can we experience this new life, this abundant life that Jesus has for us? Well, we begin by recognizing that we're sinners, that we intentionally have rebelled against God, that we intentionally run from God, and that we're indifferent to God and His ways. Romans 3:23 says this, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." So, you know, you're not alone. We've all sinned. We've all messed up. And the word sin means to miss the mark. So all of us have gone our own way, and we've missed the mark. We've tried to find our peace, and we've tried to find our hope and our assurance through maybe our works, or maybe through some religion, or maybe if I'm a really good person, and if I really do good things, maybe God will then accept me. But here's the reality. God already does accept you. Even though you've sinned, even though you've run from Him. And what's that called? Well, it's called grace. It's called God's grace. And that's not just something you do before you eat. It's something that you live into and something that you experience. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9 says this, "For it is by grace you've been saved through faith, and this is not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." Now, the word grace in its context, it means pleasure or delight. Listen, God, it's God's pleasure, and it's God's delight to save you, to deliver you, to have a relationship with you. He's been chasing you for years. He's been chasing you ever since you entered into this world. It's His delight and pleasure to know you and to have a relationship, and it's also a gift. It's just something that we simply receive from God, His love and His forgiveness. And once we receive this gift of grace, what happens? Well, God redeems us. God delivers us. Ephesians 1:7 tells us this. "We have been set free because of what Christ has done. Because He bled and died, our sins have been forgiven. We have been set free because of God's grace is so rich." So how do you receive this abundant life? How do you receive this rich life that God wants to give to us? Well, you just talk to God. I mean, He's been listening. He's been seeing. He's always been there for you. He sees your hurt. He sees your guilt and your shame. And this morning, no matter what's going on in your life, no matter how far you've fallen, no matter how long you've been searching, no matter how much guilt or shame that you may have in your life, God wants to hear from you. And it's really simple. In Romans 10:9, it says, "Say with your mouth, Jesus is Lord. Believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead. Then you will be saved." But maybe you think, you know, hey, listen, Pastor Mike, I don't think that you understand. I mean, I've really, really messed things up. I mean, I've done things I don't even think that God can forgive me of. Romans 3:22 answers that question. Because God says He will accept us and acquit us and declare us not guilty if we trust Jesus Christ to take away our sins. And we can all be saved in the same way by coming to Christ, no matter who we are or what we have been like. That's God's grace. That's God's mercy. That's God's newness, because He knows that we live in our old self. He knows that we make mistakes. He knows that we're not perfect. And the The only way for us to be forgiven is this incredible love and grace that God has for us, that no matter what, if King David can be forgiven of a murder and deceit, and if the Apostle Paul can be forgiven of killing other Christians and killing and falling away from grace and everything, God can do the same for us. So this morning, God wants to redeem you. God wants to make your life new, and He wants to deliver you into this abundant life. And again, maybe you're here, or maybe you're online, and you've just been, you've known God for years, and you just find yourself struggling, and you just need forgiveness, and you need to make things right with God. Because that's why God never gave up on us. That's why that video that we saw, that He embraced that cross for you and for me. Ephesians 53:5 says this, "But He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon Him, and by His wounds we are healed." Before I close, I'm going to pray for us here in a moment. I'm going to give you an opportunity to pray as well. I just want to share a story that I was reminded of here just recently. And I think it's about the best analogy of what the Father did when He allowed His Son to come from heaven to earth and take up on my sin and your sin. And this story is about a guy named John Griffith. And it happened in the early 1920s. And John worked for the railroad, and he was in charge of lowering and raising the drawbridge. And this is a true story. There's actually a documentary out there, I believe, called The Bridge. And his son was with him that morning, and he happened to see that the train was coming and that the drawbridge was up. And he's running to tell his father that we need to lower that. But as he was running, he got caught up in the gears. He got into a room, he got caught up in the gears. And these were the gears that lowered and raised the drawbridge. So the father noticed, and he saw the train coming, and he also knew his son was caught into the gears, but he knew that the trains that were coming, there was 400 to 500 people on passenger trains that was coming that way. And he had to make a choice very quickly. Do I go get my son and save him, or do I lower the bridge and save the 400 or 500 people that's coming? He didn't have time to do both. So in his anguish, he pulled that lever, and the drawbridge closed and crushed his son. And those who were coming across that train track, I'm sure those people on the train were addicted people. They had people in there who were selfish, people who were greedy, people who only thought about themselves. But he chose to pull that lever so that they would be saved if it meant to sacrifice his son. You see, I just want to remind you this morning that God pulled the lever for you, that He allowed His son to come from heaven to earth and go to the cross and to be crushed for my sin and for your sin. He pulled that lever and made that sacrifice. But here's the difference. Jesus willingly went to that cross. Jesus went to that cross knowing that He was dying for our sin. But He also arose. And He paved the way. He bridged, He bridged that gap between us and the Father. And this morning, He invites you into a relationship with Him, a new life with Him. So Kevin's going to come and play a little bit for us, and I'm going to pray for us as well. So I'm going to ask that you just bow your head at this time. And maybe you're here this morning, and again, maybe you're just struggling in your faith. Maybe you've known Jesus for years, but if you're honest with yourself, you've slipped back so far. You just feel like you're no longer in fellowship with Him, and you feel lost. Or maybe you're online today, or you're here, and you just never knew Him. You never experienced this abundant life, and that there is an empty void in you that only God can fill. So just pray this prayer with me as we just remember this great sacrifice that Jesus came to make all things new. Not 20%, not 50%, but to change everything 100%. And to make us more like Him. So just pray this prayer with me. Father, forgive me of my sin. I've lived against You. I've went my own way. and I've missed the mark. This morning, I'm placing my trust in you, and I believe in my heart that you have forgiven me of my sin and that you will deliver me. So forgive me of my sin. Forgive me of all those things that I've done against you and run from you and been indifferent to you, and take the throne of my life. I make you the king of my life this morning. Renew me, change me, and make me more like you. Amen. If you said that prayer this morning, I'd love to talk to you after the service and help you on your journey. If you're online, if you listen to this message, you can email me at mike@theparkchurch.com, and I would love to help you as well on your journey of faith. So as we close here, just remember this great sacrifice that God made for each one of us. Live it. God wants to renew you, and he wants to renew everything that's been going on in this country. And God is going to do that. He's going to make all things new. But you're the voice for Jesus. You're the example for Jesus. And we can wake up again every morning, and are we going to be a part of the problem or the solution? So ask God to embrace those things in you to make you a disciple and a change maker in a world that's so divided and so hurt. Next week, we're going to be talking about how God restores those things that we've lost. And we're going to be talking more about his deliverance and all the things, because God's got great things for us, things beyond what we could ever imagine. Amen? Amen. Well, God bless you, and we will see you next Sunday.